30 stocks, and out of those 30 stocks, 5 stocks became like mega multi-baggers, and other all stocks remained average. So overall return on my investment was just 5x in 5 years. So if I am a full-time investor, and if there was a big bull run, for 4 to 5x on the whole investment basket is not big. So if I want to make like 10x, 20x and 25x kind of return, I have to find only very few bets, and which are big bets and which are infrequent bets. So my investment philosophy is heads I win big, tails I don't lose much. I want to find businesses which gives me low risk value method to high returns. I want to buy business on which I can buy right and sit tight until the thesis plays out. So research, it should be a research backed idea. And for me, volatility is not a risk. Like as I said, I found this stock at 40 rupees, around 38 rupees. So it has came down to 25 rupees because of coronavirus. So I don't see volatility as a risk. Volatility is the best friend of an investor. If you had known Rakesh Jhunjhunwala bought Titan at around 7 rupees, but after that it went down to 1 rupees. And from that, right now, if you see, it is more than 1000 rupees. So if you can see volatility, if we had just sold that stock in panic, you would have not created huge wealth. So for if you have the well-researched backed idea, volatility is not a risk for you. If the stock goes down, it is a great opportunity to buy. So volatility is the best friend of an investor. Buy as low as possible. That is my mantra. See, we cannot, a lot of people think that long-term means we have to wait for 10, 15, 20 years. But people don't have that kind of patience. Why? Because there are a lot of things which might affect the business and you might exit the business in between. So for me, it becomes very important to find such 5 to 6 year patch where I can make 10 to 25x kind of returns. So I'm not a buy and hold forever kind of investor. I would like to buy the stocks which are quite low now. The businesses are great. And in the coming 5-6 years, they can do like 10 to 25x kind of returns. I'm looking at the businesses which are trading at virtual PE of 1, 5 to 6 year forward, which means ability to generate equivalent kind of profit. See, let me tell you this. If you all not understood market cap, what is market cap? See, if you just multiply the share price into total number of shares which are available in market and with the promoters, you will get a market cap. What is market cap? If you want to buy the whole company, how much you need to pay? So market cap is the current valuation of a company according to the current market price. So I want to find such businesses which are trading at virtual PE of 1. What is virtual PE of 1? Means, let us say if a company's total valuation today is 1000 crores. So my research should say that by 5 years hence, that company should be able to generate a profit of 1000 crore. So equivalent to the current market cap. So if we can do that, we will be winning big. We will be winning big. Why? Because market goes crazy about such stocks. And there, if you find the 7000 stocks, you will not get more than 5 to 7 such opportunities wherein 5 to 6 years forward, they are trading at 1 PE. So this is my investment philosophy. As I told, I have learned all by doing mistakes. Earlier, when I was in 2011, I used to buy 30 stocks. Now I don't like to buy more than 10 stocks. So my quality has improved, my focus has increased, and I look at the businesses which only create huge wealth. I find the business heads I win big, tails I don't lose much. Or I have, because of coronavirus, actually we are getting some businesses for free. So I'll be talking about that later in the next webinar. So it is actually heads I win and tails I don't lose at all. That kind of opportunity. So right now, the business attributes. So if you have seen my investment philosophy, so according to the investment philosophy, what I need to check in a business. So I need to check that business is low debt or debt free company. It is having a sound business model, high promoter holding, very low or low pledge shares, very old business, at least 15 years old. easy to understand business, good management pedigree and trustworthy promoters, growing sales, growing profits, stock near or below intrinsic values, stocks which are cyclical will benefit from the business upcycle and commodity upcycle, promoter increasing stake, high return on equity, high return on capital employed, companies benefiting from operating leverage in future due to underutilized capacity currently, low peg ratio and high interest coverage. So if I can find businesses with these, like for example, high competitive advantage due to long standing relationship. See, if you have seen, a lot of businesses are 10 to 15 year old. So if they are 10 to 15 year old and in their customers are also 10, 15 year old, they have a good competitive advantage because customers don't leave this company for any other superior product. Why? Because there is a long standing relationship. Because of this long standing relationship, what happens is it creates a high competitive advantage. And usually I buy debt free and cash rich companies or the companies which are having bargaining power with their supplier. So if the company is the market leader, automatically this company will be having a bargaining power with their suppliers. I like to buy business which are low on receivable days, which are having high entry barriers due to location advantage. For example, in case of a cement plant, what happens is if the cement plant is closer to the raw material and market, it has a great location advantage because every cement manufacturer, the production process is same. However, the company may save money only on freight cost or transportation cost, that is what I call. So if the company is having location advantage, only then they can make big profits in cement company. So in such cases, I want to have those businesses, want to own those businesses which are having high entry barriers due to location advantage and huge capital investment to replace their capacities as a competitor. So even if the competitor wants to set up the plant as the capacity what I am having, they will be requiring huge capex. So it is not possible for a new player to start a plant. So I am looking at such businesses. I am looking at the businesses which are depressed, which are having depressed earning now in cyclical stock. But as the debt-free companies or the market leader, these will be the least affected compared to the competitors and bound to do the best in the industry as the tide turns. So those who are not debt-free but has a big debt should provide a confidence about the repayment. I love to buy the businesses which are old school, old economy stocks with the no replacement for the products seen in their decade. So for example, I always talk about circle of competence. What circle of competence means is, if you have not worked in an industry, how can you comment about that business just by seeing annual report, just by seeing analyst report and all? So if you have not worked in an industry, worked in a business, you cannot speak 100% confidently about the assessment which you have taken out. So personally, I have been working with my father in metal trading business and in metals. I used to trade in metals. So I was also involved in trading business and I was also involved in mutual fund distribution. And after that, I worked with JSW Steel for 6 months. And I also worked for 1.5 years for NJ India Invest, which is the biggest mutual fund distributor in India. So these are my circle of competence. Broking industry is also my circle of competence. Because as I have worked in this industry, I can better judge these businesses very well. So I don't touch the businesses which I don't understand. Like for example, I cannot talk about telecom because I don't know the economics of telecom. Just telling that, just by reading and understanding, if you have done business, then you would have been Ambani. It is not like that. To do business, it requires skill. So if you can understand only those businesses, then you need to do only those businesses and you need to invest only those stocks. So if you go and buy, if I had not worked in oil industry and if I go and buy Reliance, how will I come to know when it is doing bad? I will not come to know 100%. But however, if I have worked in an industry, if I know the industry, how it is going, it is no problem for me, even if it is going through a rough period. I look at old school economies. So old economy stocks and old economy business is my circle of competence. I don't go beyond my circle of competence and I stay focused. I love to buy businesses which are having promoter experience in the same business of more than a decade and having a proven track record. So if you, according to this business philosophy, investment philosophy and these business attributes, I screen out the businesses, and after screening out, I got not more than 10 businesses. So out of that 10 business, again, I chose five such businesses. I chose five such gems which can create fortune for us. This webinar is to create fortune. If somebody wants to compare my strategy and idea with mutual fund or any other person, this webinar is not for you, because this webinar is only for those people who want to create fortune. I'm not talking about wealth. Wealth means doubling your money in 5 years or 6 years. That is wealth. But fortune means in 5 to 6 year period, you are willing to make, you are willing to take 30 to 40% decline. And at the same time on the upside, you want to make like 10 to 25x kind of return. So if you are looking for a investment research or investment views which can give you 15-20% return, this webinar is not for you. This webinar is only for those people who want to create fortune in stock markets. So I'll be talking about fortune creation. So let us talk about fortune creation. The first phase of fortune creation in stock market was between 1995 to 2002. So you would have been crore prati if you had bought some of these stocks in 1996 to 2002 phase. Why I'm talking 1996 to 2002? Because earlier before that, it was a Harshad Mehta scam and it was artificial stock. Stocks were going up. So because of that, I have not chosen that period. After the Harshad Mehta scam, I have taken first period of fortune creation. In the first period of fortune creation, if you had seen, if you had bought Britannia in 1995, it was trading at 10 to 15 rupees. And by 1999, it became 100 to 120 rupees. So why I'm showing you is, in just 5 years, this stock became 10x. So I'm talking about 5 to 6 years. I'm talking about Vision 2025. So if I want to talk about next 5 years, I want to show you what 5 years can create wealth. So Britannia became 10x in 5 years from 1995 to 1999. ITC became 6x in 5 years. It was trading at 4 to 6 rupees in 1995. And by 1999, it was trading at 20 to 25 rupees. So it became 6x in 4 to 5 years. At the same time, see, if you have seen FMCG and all these ITC and these stocks, they have created like 10x to 6x kind of return. However, at the same point of time, if you had bought Wipro in 1995 to 1997, it was trading at 1 rupees 20 paisa to 1 rupees 95 paisa. That stock went to 440 rupees and Wipro created like 200x kind of wealth. So if you had invested 1 lakh rupees, then in 5 years, your 1 lakh rupees would have turned to 2 crore rupees in just 5 years. So that is the power of fortune creation in stock market if you just bet on the right stock. So if you have seen Infosys also became 200x. In 1995, it was trading at around 1 rupee and by 2000 it was trading at around 200 rupees. Later on it came down to 114 rupees again. So if somebody had bought Infosys, like Ramesh Damani is a celebrity investor, he made more than 50x kind of return in Infosys. So if you had 50x is also a big amount. So if the stock has gone up 200x, you can even make 20x and 30x and 50x kind of such stocks. So Dr. Reddy's in 1995 to 2000 period, Dr. Reddy's were trading at 40 rupees and it was trading at 400 rupees in year 2000. So Dr. Reddy's became 10x in 5 years. However, if these stocks have created wealth, you all would have thought that most of the stocks went up and created fortune for the shareholders. But it is not like that. However, if you had bought these stocks, you have wasted your time, money, and effort if you have bought Tata Steel. At the same time, when Wipro became 200x, Infosys became 200x, Tata Steel came down from 170 rupees to 30 to 40 rupees in 2001. So you have eroded like 60 to 70% of your wealth in Tata Steel. So at the same point of time, when Wipro created Infosys, these are new economy stocks created wealth. Old economy stocks like Tata Steel and now BHEL, that is Bharat Heavy Electricals. BHEL was trading at 10 to 15 rupees in 1995. It was trading at 10 to 15 rupees again in 2001 to 2002. So you would have wasted your time, money and effort if you had bought at the same point of time in 1995 if you had bought BHEL. So you have not created wealth. And by year 2000, actually BHEL went down from 20 rupees to 5 rupees. So you would have lost huge wealth. Steel Authority of India Limited, it was trading at 55 rupees in 1995. And by year 2000, it was trading at 4 rupees 25 paisa. So at the same time, when Infosys became 200x and Wipro became 200x, sale eroded investors' wealth or invested for investors' money by 90%. Vedanta, it was trading at 12 to 13 rupees in 1995. Again, it was trading at 1 to 2 rupees in 2001 to 2002. So, at the same time, when Wipro became 200x, Vedanta lost 90% of its value. Larsen & Toubro, it was trading at 42 rupees in 96. And again, by 2003, in 6 to 7 year period, again, it was trading at 42 rupees. So, if you had bought Larsen & Toubro instead of Wipro, your money was stuck. You have not created any wealth in stock markets from 1995 to 2002. So from this, it is clearly evident that just staying long term for 5-6 years, you will not be creating wealth. It is very important to find the right stock or the right sector. So from 1995 to 2002, it was the period of new economy stocks like Infosys, Wipro and Pharma and FMCG. So, pharma, FMCG and IT created huge wealth for the investors from 96 to 2002. At the same point of time, if you had bought old economy stock, you have lost wealth like anything. So, let us talk about second fortune creation phase in Indian stock market. First fortune creation phase was from 96 to 2002. Second phase is from 2002 to 2008. So, in this 6-year period, if somebody had bought these stocks, they have wasted time, money and energy if they had bought these stocks. Like Infosys was trading at 200 rupees in 2000 and by year 2006 to 2007 again it was trading at 200 to 220. So if somebody had bought Infosys just by looking at the past that it is increasing and it is going to become more valuable, then you would have lost 80% of your wealth. So do you think that from year 2000 to 2006, Infosys earnings did not rise? It is not like that. Infosys continued to show profit growth. However, Infosys stock came down 80%. So from in 6-year period, Infosys has not created any wealth. So this is clearly evident that if you just chasing stock, I have seen lot of people chasing the stocks like Nestle, the stocks like Britannia, just because they have become big multi-baggers in the last 5 years. If you have seen, I'll show you the example. So, from 96 to 2002, lot of FMCG created wealth. From 2000 to 2006-07, Infosys lost 80%. So, Dr. Reddy's, if you've seen, if you have just bought Dr. Reddy's, just by thinking that from 96 to 2000, it has become like 10x. And if you think that Dr. Reddy's is a great business and it is into pharma and the business will never die and this business will continue to grow well, you are wrong. Why? Because Dr. Reddy's was trading at 600 rupees in 2001 and again by 2010. So in 9 years, the stock was up just by 200 rupees from 600 to 800. So if you have thought that Dr. Reddy's is a good company, it is in pharma, and if you had bought this stock just thinking that the earning will be are good and company is good and pharma is evergreen, you will not create any wealth and nobody can catch the bottom. Let me tell you, if you think that I would have bought at bottom. So if the range of Dr. Reddy's was between 600 to 800. So if somebody had bought Dr. Reddy's, the prices are same for him for 10 years. So Hindustan Unilever, Hindustan Unilever became 10x from 96 to 2000. However, Hindustan Unilever, it was trading at 300 rupees in year 2000. And by year 2009 to 2010, again, it was trading at 300 rupees. So if you had thought that Unilever is a consistent performer, it is a profit generating machine, it is a profit generating business, and it is basic goods. So you will not be creating any wealth from 2000 to 2010. Why? Because it was trading at the same range from 300 to 300. So do you think that in Hindustan Unilever's profit did not rise from year 2000 to 2010? It is not like that. The stock prices did not rise because earlier it was a performing stock. So after a huge performance comes underperformance, and after huge underperformance comes overperformance. So you need to be very clear that we need to buy the businesses which are in favor, which may come in favor after a long period of time. So Hindustan Unilever for 10 years, no return at all. It is better to keep the money in FD than to put in Hindustan Unilever. However, at the same point of time, if somebody had bought BHEL, so see, from 96 to 2000, it was a period of FMCG, pharma and IT. From 2002 to 2008, it was a period of, it was not a period of pharma, FMCG and IT. However, at the same point of time, when old economies struggled from 96 to 2000, again, old economy stocks like BHEL, it was trading at 229 rupees in 2003. And by year 2008, it was trading at 370 rupees. So it became 30x in 5 years. So the stock did not perform from 95 to 2000. It performed after 2002 and it became 13x. So if somebody had bought this stock in 1995-96, you would have lost patience and you would have sold. And after he had sold, a lot of people experienced that. After holding for a lot longer period of time and they just sell it. And after that, the stock become 10x and 20x kind of return. So you need to find the business at the right time. People tell that just keeping long term for stock market, you can create wealth. But people don't have patience like to wait for 10, 15, 20 years. So if a person can find such 5-6 year period where he can make 10x, it is a great thing. So at the same time, when Larsen was trading in same range from 95 to 2002, but however, Larsen was trading at 40 rupees in 2002, and by 2008, it became 1000 rupees. So it went up 20x in 6 years. So Larsen and Toubro, when it did not perform for 6 to 7 years, L&T, same L&T was a multi-bagger from 2002 to 2008. So it shows that long period of underperformance brings a good period of outperformance. This is what mean reversion called. So whenever you become a part of my Telegram channel, automatically I will be sharing you all those videos which you require to learn. Unless and until you become a learning machine, you will not be able to make such kind of profits. Even if you have listened to this webinar and just invest in stock, you can buy the idea. But where will you get conviction? Conviction comes from own assessment and own research and own studies and own confidence. So I'll be telling you about the stock. But to build conviction, you need to be connected with my Telegram channel, wherein I'll be sharing lot of learning things, which like mean reversion and all. So I'll be sharing all those meaningful stuff which can help you create wealth in stock markets. So at the same point of time, when SEL eroded 90% of its wealth from 96 to 2000, it became like 30x from year 2002. It was trading at 9 rupees. And by year 2008, it was trading at 290 rupees. So this stock became 30x in 6 years. So if somebody had bought Steel Authority at 55 rupees in 1996, then for his price to come, it had taken from 1997 to 2005. It is almost like 8 years. It took 8 years for him to come to his price. So at the same point of time, if somebody had bought Steel Authority at 9 rupees in 2002, he had created like 30x. So just by waiting for 5-6 years, you can get 10 to 20x, 30x kind of return. You don't need to wait for 10, 15 years to create huge wealth in stock market. Like Tata Steel from 2002 to 2008, in just five years, it became 11x. It was trading at 70 rupees in 2002. And by 2007 to 2008, it was trading at 8850 rupees. It became 11x in 6 years. So this is to prove that in 5 years, we can make 10x. That is why I'm giving you some examples. Vedanta, as I told, it eroded like 80% from 96 to 2002. However, if somebody had bought Vedanta in 2002 to 2003 period, it was trading at 1 rupees 20 paisa to 1 rupees 80 paisa. And in just 6 years, Vedanta became 150x from that price. Vedanta went up to 220 rupees in 2008. So if somebody had bought Vedanta at the right point, then he would have created like 150x kind of returns. Unitech, again, it is a old economy stocks. So from 2002 to 2008 period, it is clearly evident that old economy stocks like Steel Authority, Vedanta, L&T, BHEL and Unitech, all these old economy stocks created huge wealth. However, at the same point of time, Infosys, Dr. Reddy's, Pharma, IT and FMCG did not create wealth. So from 1996 to 2002 was a period of IT, pharma and FMCG. From 2002 to 2008, it was a period of old economy stocks like L&T and all, Vedanta and old businesses, economy stocks. And Unitech also, it is an old economy stock. It was trading at 50 paisa in 2002. It became like 1000x in 6 years and it went to 530 rupees in 2008. So Dolly Khanna made hundreds of crores from Unitech. You can just search Dolly Khanna and Unitech. You will come to know that Dolly Khanna, how much she made, how much it is her husband called as Rajiv Khanna. He created fortune from Unitech stock. Now let us talk about third phase of fortune creation in Indian stock market. Third phase of fortune creation of Indian stock markets starts from 2008 to 2014 and 14 to 2020. So as we have seen, from 2002 to 2008 period, it was a period of old economy stock. So at the same point of time, when from 2002 to 2008, pharma did not perform. However, from 2008 onwards, pharma started performing and Dr. Reddy's became 10x. So Dr. Reddy's, which remained stagnant for 10 years from 2002 to 2008 period, 6 years, that became 10x in just next 6 years. It was trading at 400 rupees in 2008 and by 2015, it was trading at 4000 rupees. So this clearly tells you that long period of underperformance brings a medium term outperformance. Medium performance in 5 to 6 years. So Ajanta Pharma, it was trading at 28 rupees. See the chart of Ajanta Pharma from 2001 to 2008 period. It was pretty flat. So after a long period of underperformance, what happened is, because 2002 to 2008 period was a bad period for pharma. So at that same time, Ajanta Pharma was not performing. See, the chart is flat from 2001 to 2008. However, if somebody had bought Ajanta Pharma in 2008 period at 28 rupees, it became 80x in 8 years. Actually, it was trading at 2000 rupees in 2016. So Ajanta Pharma became 80x in just 8 years. If somebody had bought this stock, they have created like 80x. If a stock has gone up 80x, if at least some investor have made like 25 to 30x. some funds in Motilal Oswal funds, they have created like 25 to 30x returns in Ajanta Pharma. You can just verify it. So from 2008 to 2014, Bajaj Finance, it was trading at 5 rupees in 2008. And in just 12 years, it was trading at recently 4,900. So it became 900x. So if somebody had invested 1 lakh rupees, his 1 lakh has turned into 9 crore rupees. If somebody had bought at 5 rupees. However, nobody can catch the bottom. Somebody who had bought at 25 rupees also, for him also it is more than 200 times. Even if he had put 1 lakh, that 1 lakh would have turned into 2 crores. However, when these all stock created huge wealth for the investor, if somebody had bought these other stocks, they have wasted their time, money and effort. So from 2014, if somebody had bought the Ajanta Pharma, same Ajanta Pharma, just thinking that from 2008 to 2014, it has gone up, let me buy this. If you had bought this stock in 2014 and 2015, it was trading at 1,400. And here, even after this coronavirus and lot of positive news for pharma, again it is trading at 1,400. So what is the use of it? So do you think that Ajanta Pharma did not do profit from 2014 to 2020 for 6 years? It is not like that. It is just that the sector is out of favor. Pharma is out of favor. So DLF again, it was trading at 1,100. Now it is trading at 120. It lost 90%. Sector is out of favor. Steel Authority, if somebody had bought, looking at the past return from 2002 to 2008 period, Steel Authority was trading at 300 rupees in 2008. To recent low, it made around 20 and they would have lost like 90% wealth. So from 2008 to 2020, this entire sector is out of favor. Tata Steel again, no returns from the last 10 years. So what are the learnings are? Learnings are 8 to 10 years of sectorial underperformance brings 4 to 6 years of outperformance. And selective stocks, if picked right, with great delta in profits can create fortune for investors. I am talking about fortune, not wealth. Why? Because I am a full-time investor and I am interested to create fortune. I am not here to create wealth, because if I had to create wealth, I would have invested in mutual funds. Mutual funds are better for the people who want 15% returns. But I am not happy with that. Why? Because I am a full-time investor. For me, it becomes very important to find such patch to create like 10x kind of return in 5 years. So, for example, from 2002 to 2008 was a period of entire pharma sector was out of favor. However, pharma companies continued to show earnings growth. But means profits were continuously growing. But pharma companies starting coming in favor in 2008. And by 2015, selective stocks like Ajanta Pharma became 80x, which was trading at ridiculously low valuation in 2007 to 2008. So no matter how continuous profit a company generates, if the sector is out of favor, then no one can make fortune creating profits. Only betting blindly on long term is very difficult, because people don't have unlimited patience, because we all have limited time on this planet. We can dedicate 5-6 years for a stock, but we cannot dedicate 10-15-20 years. Gone are the days when you would have held these stocks for 15-20. We have seen lot of examples like S Bank and all. So it becomes very important to generate fortune in 5-6 year period. So finding a patch of 5-6 period of super normal period can be extremely rewarding. So this is what the learnings what I have. See, I have been in markets from last 13 years. So for me now, it is very important to create fortune in next 5-6 years. Because earlier I used to do like, I was not focused, but now today I'm more focused, and earlier I used to buy 30 stocks and now I cut down to 7 to 10 stocks. So I don't like more than 10 stocks. So I have actually sent you all an email. In that email, I sent you one link, very important link, that this is the past. This is what I called about past. And it is very clearly evident that if you find a sector leader, and in that sector leader you find a good company, you can make like 80x kind of return, such like Ajanta Pharma. So the question comes that what will be the next bull market leader? What sector or what stock will be the bull leader of next bull market? So there is, I sent you all an email and link of blog where I wrote about why old economy stock will be leaders of next bull market. So let us talk about that. See, from 2002 to 2008 period, it was a golden period for old economy stocks, like old economy businesses. Like from 2002, because of golden quadrilateral of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, highways from Mumbai connecting to Delhi, Delhi connecting to Bangalore, Bangalore connecting to Kolkata, Kolkata connecting to again Delhi. So this was a golden quadrilateral. There were a lot of infrastructure projects, and because of that, what happened? From 2002 to 2008 period, actually what all work started by the Atal Bihari government, it continued, and because of that, it was a flourishing period and brought lot of people in this sector thought that this will continue for another 10 years. And that all these, like Tata Steel, Steel Authority, they all increased capacity. Like Bhushan Steel, they all increased capacity. They doubled the capacity, tripled the capacity. And because of that, what happened? It created huge overcapacity in the sector, which was haunting this sector from the past 10 years. So if you have seen from 2008 to 2018 or 20, lot of new steel plants have not came. Why? Because the entire sector was seeing NPA issue. There was entire stress in the economy. Because of that, it was haunting the sector from the past 10 years. However, after the consolidation in the sector, because of bankruptcy code, what has happened? Every promoter is now fearing that they may lose their business. If you have seen, Bhushan Steel was sold to Tata Steel, and SR Steel was sold to ArcelorMittal. So what has happened? Because of bankruptcy code, the promoters are kicked away and the new promoters are coming and they are getting bought by the stronger players. So the consolidation, no new plants are coming. Already the consolidation is happening. So if you believe after the growth comes consolidation and after consolidation again comes growth. So if you believe in this, then after a long period of consolidation of 10 years, this sector is set for the next leg of growth, profitable growth. So I believe 2020 to 2026. So I thought that from 2020, but because of Corona, what has happened? This will start from 2021 because 2020 will be washed out in Corona. So because coronavirus came out of syllabus for me. So from 2021 to 2026, it will be a golden period for old economy stocks and old school businesses like cement, infra and steel. Indian banking sector has just came out of ICU. What I call as ICU means NPA cycle. What is NPA? If you give 100 rupees loan outside and if you don't get 10 rupees of loan coming back, it is called as non-performing asset or bad debts. So from last 10 years, what the sector has become bad, banking sector, it has just came out of the ICU after the NPA cycle because of bankruptcy code and all. It cannot afford to go again into ICU by lending again to steel companies and the sectors in cement and power. So because of this, what happens in the steel, even if new players think that I want to set up a plant, bank will not be ready to give them loan because after coming out of ICU, they will think that they should become stable first and then lend. So for the next 3 years, I am seeing a tight supply for the money. So it cannot afford to go again into ICU by lending to steel companies. The sectors will be facing credit crunch, thus disrupting the supply. So this supply, if the money is not there, automatically new plants will not come up. If the new plants will not come, then what happens is supply is disrupted, and because of short supply and the demand is increasing day by day because of Sagarmala, Bharatmala and all. And even after Corona, if we have to kickstart the economy, either government has to spend on infrastructure to boost the country's economy, or they have to give the money in pockets of citizen so that they will spend more and bring consumption in the economy. So I think that government will not give the money in the pockets of common people. I think that government, if they have to stand still, if they have to come out of this crisis, and if they have to create new jobs, they have to spend more on infrastructure. So I think the demand will be increasing. 60% of the demand for steel comes from infrastructure, and if infrastructure spend will be going on great, then automatically there will be a tight demand and a tight supply because of money not going into these sectors. So there will be a rich demand pricing scenario over the medium term for the next 3 to 4 years. So there is a strong case for commodity companies. For example, if the prices starts increase, if you believe in economics, demand supply game, supply is tight and demand goes on increasing, the prices will increase. So because of that, what happens is, if the prices increase, those who are sitting at idle capacity, like for example, if the plant is having 100% capacity and they are working at 60% capacity now, in going future, if the demand increases, other people who are working at 100%, they will not be making big profits. However, at the same point of time, the people who are sitting at 60% capacity utilization, they can scale up their production from 60 to 100. So they will be big winners. So we need to find such businesses which are working at lower capacity currently, and which are market leaders, and which have big capacity and which can disrupt the market. So we need to find such businesses. So there is a strong case for the commodity companies. I will be talking about that in the next slide. I'll be talking about why old economy stocks will be the leaders of next bull market. See, this is a chart of commodity index. If you see the commodity index is trading at 30-year low. If you see this commodity index, what all it comprises? It comprises of crude, steel, copper, and all other commodities. So all these commodities are mixed to create a commodity index. So this commodity index shows you the pricing scenario of commodities, entire commodity sector. So if you have seen recently crude, if you have seen, it went very low, and most of the country's cost of production is around $20 to $25, and the crude price went below that. So because of that, it won't remain long there. Why? Because if the country has to grow after this coronavirus is solved, automatically the prices will rise. If you have seen, why I'm talking about old economy stocks is because, see, in 1998, there was a big crash in commodity. And after that big crash, what happened? It started rising from 1998. And after that, this commodity index, like for example, crude oil went from $25 to $30 to $140 in 2008. So it was a big jump. So all these commodities, there was a mega bull run in commodities in 1998 to 2008 period. So if you see this, after a big crash comes a big rise. So again, if you have seen, there is a big crash right now. Commodity price index is trading at 30-year low. So whenever that has happened, there is a big rise in commodity prices. I will show you one more chart. Oh, so I forgot to bring that chart. Just be connected with me in the next webinar. I'll be sharing with you chart. Today I forgot to bring that chart. I'll be sharing that chart with you all, which will show you clear direction. So where we are now. So after a big crash comes a big rise. So this gives you a clear view that most of the commodities, like for example, crude oil, it is trading below cost of production. Recently, I wrote a blog on ferrosilicon also. Recently, ferrosilicon prices went below cost of production. And I wrote to all my JV partners, those people who are associated with me for fortune creation. I told them that these prices cannot remain here for long. The cost of production was 67 rupees in Bhutan, which is the biggest producer of ferrosilicon, and the prices went down to 65 rupees. So Bhutan is the lowest cost manufacturer of ferrosilicon. So if that player if the prices goes below that, it is a great buying opportunity. Why? Because at some point of time, if these all players who are having lowest cost manufacturing ability, they all will stop manufacturing and there will be short supply. And because of short supply, automatically prices will increase. So that is what happened in April 2019 or May 2019 last year. I told to buy ferrosilicon in physical and it was trading at 65 rupees. Before Corona, it went up to 94 rupees. So in just 1 year, it went up like 50 to 60%. If a commodity has went up 50, 60%, some of the companies in that, if the companies are good and the market is good, that stock can create fortune for the investors. So today I will be talking about the stock. Just if you have seen all my slides, now you are very clear that next upcoming bull market sector is old economy sector. And as I told, my circle of competence, as I told, I have worked in JSW Steel for 6 months as an intern. So I understand this business very much. So I can relate various things. So if somebody gives me a consultant, I can set up a steel plant on my own, just like Tata Steel, Steel Authority. This is just a metaphor. But however, this is the way of saying that if you understand the business in whole, then if you find such an opportunity, you will be a better judge of that opportunity. So today we will be talking about Steel Authority of India Limited and why it is a fortune builder, why it can become 20x by 2025, 2026 from the current price. So lot of people, when I say about Steel Authority, actually they don't like this business at all. Why? Because from the last 10 years, it has not performed. And because of that, lot of people think that Steel Authority cannot create wealth. And lot of people, when I talk about Steel Authority, they think that this is a government company, sarkari company, kab badega. It is not like that. It is just a myth. I can share you 10 to 15 examples wherein government companies have created like 100x kind of wealth. So it is not like that. Again, see, Steel Authority was down 90% from 1995 to 1996. So, 1996 to 2000 period. However, when the sector started coming in favor, the stock went up from 4 rupees in 2001 to around 350 rupees in 2008. So it created huge. But after, as I told, there are very obvious reasons. 10 years was bad period for this sector, entire old economy stock. So Steel Authority, it came down from 280 to 21 rupees. So don't you think that this current situation of price, which is down from 260 to 21 rupees, is similar to this? So if you can correlate this, both these things. So current situation from 2010 to 2020, it is same situation from what it happened from 1995 to 2002 period. So it is very obvious that if a stock, and we have seen it in past, if a stock has gone down 90%, so just to come at its original price, it will create you 10x if a stock has gone down 90%. So you cannot just buy blindly the stock which has gone down 90%. You need to have strong research and to tell you that you can buy this business. See, facts about Steel Authority is, Steel Authority has a installed capacity of 21.4 million ton per annum. 1 million is 10 lakh and 21.4 means 2 crore ton per annum is the annual capacity, steel capacity of Steel Authority of India Limited. As I told you, current capacity utilization is 65%. So, if this company is having a capacity of 21.4 million ton per annum, this company is producing steel of 14.5 million ton per annum. So, it has an idle capacity of 7 million ton. So, if you can see, if the demand increases, they have enough room to produce from 65% currently 200%, which is 21.4 million ton. And in past, from 1995 to 2002 and 2002 to 2008, they already work like 100% capacity utilization. So current market cap of the company is 11,000 crore. So if you want to buy the whole company, you can buy this company at 11,000 crores. Let me tell you this concept, replacement cost. Let us see if I want to start my own steel plant. So to set up one steel plant, it requires 6,500 crores. So current capacity of Steel Authority is 21.4 million ton. So if you just multiply 21.4 million ton by 6,500, it comes like 1,39,000 crore. So the setup cost for replacement cost for the current capacity is 1,39,000. However, the current market cap is just 11,000 crore, which is a big discount to its valuation. So why there is a big discount? There is obvious reasons also. I'll tell you about that. Government company will be having like sovereign guarantee. Like this is like a government company. This is a government company actually. A lot of investors have lost wealth because of promoter fraud, like Gitanjali Gems, like DHFL and all. So at least in the Steel Authority, we don't have that kind of issue wherein you'll be losing money because of fraud. So as this is a government company, this is like having a sovereign guarantee. So sales debt was 13,000 crore. Let me tell you, from 2003 to 2008 period, Steel Authority went up 30x. So in 2003 period, it was having a debt of 13,000 crore. And by 2008, it was having a debt of minus 12,000 crore, which means it had a cash of 12,000 crore. So in 2008, it was having a free cash of 12,000 crore. So during good times, sales debt, 13,000 crore debt converted into 12,000 crore cash. So because of that only, the share price rose from rose like 30x in just 7 years. Steel Authority's capacity in 2003 was 7 million ton per annum. Right now the capacity is 21.4 million ton per annum. Sales debt now is around 50,000 crore at prox. So it is not a debt free company, but as I told again, in 2003, as I told, it was having a debt of around 13,000 crore and capacity of 7 million ton per annum. If you just multiply by 3, current capacity is 21.4. So if you just see, 50,000 crore may seem as a big debt. However, if you just see by the capacity, debt is very manageable. Why? Because 13,000 into 3, 13,3 is 39, which is almost 40,000 crore. So the current debt is only 20%, 25% higher than the 2003 period. So I don't think that is a big debt for the Steel Authority. And they have a lot of assets which can be sold. They will be selling some plants which will generate cash for them. So sell expected debt. This is what I am assuming. 2025 to 2026, like what happened from 2003 to 2008, it went from debt heavy company to debt free company, and Steel Authority also will become debt free or cash rich company or debt light company by 2025-2026. So in last steel upcycle, sale become like 20x, 3x in 5 years. It was trading at 12 rupees in 2003 and it was trading at 280 rupees in 2008, it became like 20x in 23x. Actually, if somebody had bought at 4 rupees in 2000, it was trading at 4 rupees in year 1999. So for him, it is like more than 80x kind of return. So it is a myth that you need to pick the right business at right time. Otherwise, you will not be able to create wealth. Steel Authority has 5 integrated steel plants. See, if you can see, these are closer to each other, like Bhilai Steel Plant, Bokaro Steel Plant, Burnpur, Durgapur and Rurkela. So this is situated, these companies, Steel Authority, have their own captive mines, iron ore mines. And because of that, they have a raw material security for next 20 years at least. So a lot of people tell that why do you want to buy Steel Authority and not JSW Steel and Tata Steel? So let me do a comparison between these all. So current installed capacity of JSW Steel is 18 million ton. Tata Steel is 18 million ton, India. And including Europe, it is 25 million ton. Steel Authority is having 21.4 million ton. So if you can see, Steel Authority is the biggest player in India. It is bigger than JSW Steel and Tata Steel. Debt to equity. Debt to equity means current owner's fund compared to the outsider's fund taken on loans. So if you just compare that, debt to equity for JSW Steel is 1.12 times. For Tata Steel, it is 1.4 times. And for Steel Authority, it is 1.23 times. So those who are thinking that Steel Authority debt is huge, it is not huge. It is actually in line with the industry norms. Why? Because Tata Steel is trading at 1.4 times debt to equity. Steel Authority is trading at 1.23 times book value, debt to equity. So it is not a big issue. It is just in line with the industry. Just because of the market cap and price, they think that this is a big debt. I don't see it is a big debt. And apart from that, what is the biggest advantage that Steel Authority has? As I told you all that, like for example, for JSW Steel to put up a 1 million ton steel plant, it requires 3 years. So if they start capacity expansion now, it will be completed by 2022 or 2023. So right now, JSW Steel is working at a capacity utilization of 95%. So if they are able to produce 100, they will they have a capacity of 100. They will be able, they are producing 95. Max they can do is 100. So if the demand increases, this JSW Steel doesn't have much capacity to perform better. However, if you see Tata Steel, same it is, again it is working at 95% capacity. And Steel Authority, why it is trading as working at 65% capacity utilization? As it is a government company, government projects takes much time to complete, and they thought of expansion some 6 years back, and which they wanted to complete it by 2015 or 2016, but they completed it by 2018. Because of that, what has happened? Because of the late completion, actually that has helped them. Why? Because of the late expansion, they have not lost money during bad period. Now when the good times are about to start, these companies were having a extra capacity because its steel plant capacity moved 50% up from 16 million ton to 21 million ton. So its capacity increased. And the production is slowly increasing. Right now, they are having a capacity utilization of 65%. When the demand increases, Tata Steel and JSW Steel will be at disadvantage, and Steel Authority will be at big advantage. Why? Because without doing much work, spending much money on the capex capacity expansion, they can do big sales. If you see the market cap of the company, so this is the biggest advantage, and also debt to equity front, having lower debt than Tata Steel, and on the capacity front, it is the biggest player. So you are getting Steel Authority at biggest player, relatively okay debt to equity, and sitting at idle capacity. And on the valuation front also, if you see 18 million ton steel plant of JSW Steel, current market cap is 36,000 crore. 18.5 million ton of steel plant of Tata Steel is trading at 32,000 crore market cap. So if you see Steel Authority, it is just trading at 9 to 10,000 crore market cap. So it is one third valuation compared to JSW Steel and Tata Steel. So at the same point of time, their debt to equity is less. Their capacity utilization is good. Because of that, they are at big advantage. This is the biggest player in India. And they are trading very low in market cap. So market cap as a percentage of replacement cost, if you see, JSW Steel is working at 26% of its replacement cost. Tata Steel is working at 19% of the replacement cost. And Steel Authority is working only at 6% of replacement cost. Earlier, I told 1 million ton of steel plant, if you want to start, then you need 6500 crores of money. So if you see by replacement calls also, Steel Authority is trading cheaper than all other players. So if you see from price to book also, price to book means book value means if you are having total assets of 100 rupees and let us say if you are having total shares 10. So if you just divide the total assets, total net worth divided by number of shares, you will be getting book value per share. So here in case it comes 10 rupees book value. So in case if we compare that with price, if the book value is 10 rupees and the share price is 20 rupees, that means that it is trading two times the book value. So price to book, that is what price to book is. So if you see JSW Steel, it is trading at one times price to book. Tata Steel, it is trading 0.4 times price to book. And Steel Authority, it is trading at 0.22 times price to book. So it is biggest player, it is having manageable debt, it is having working at low capacity utilization, the market cap is low, valuations are low, price to book is low, and because of that, I like more Steel Authority compared to JSW Steel and Tata Steel. But some people argue that JSW Steel is an efficient player, Tata Steel is an efficient player, and Steel Authority is not. Let me tell you that answer. See, this is a chart of labor productivity of Steel Authority of India Limited from 2009 to 2019. So if you have seen the period of 10 years, in 2009 to 2010, they were having total employees of 1,16,950. So if you see, the labor productivity was 226 ton per employee per annum. So the labor productivity was low. If you have seen, from 1,16,000 employees, actually in 2010, their capacity was around 15 to 16 million ton. Right now, the capacity has grown to 21 million ton. And at the same point of time, their employees are reducing. So this company is not working as a government company. Actually, this is working as a private company. They are increasing their capacity. They are increasing their business. They are upgrading the plant. At the same point of time, they are reducing the employee count. So it was working as a social company in 2010. The employee count was 1,16,000. From that, it has came down to 1,10,000 in 2011, 1,06,000 in 2012, 1,93,000 in 2015. And by now in 2018, 2019, it was the count was 72,000. So again, I think more 10,000 employees may go because of voluntary retirement and just because of some so plants getting sold. Because of that, what will happen? This company will be having lower. So if you, even if you see the Tata Steel's, JSW Steel's labor productivity is 650. And this labor productivity, Steel Authority's labor productivity has increased from 226 in 2010 to around 389 in 2018-19. So labor productivity is on increase. I feel going forward, this labor productivity will go to 450. Earlier, its employee cost as a percentage of sales was 17%. And it has came down to 6% now. So it is becoming a more efficient player. So there is a significant enhancement in labor productivity. So I think there is one more thing why I think that Steel Authority should be bought. See, if you have seen this government, current government, they don't have cash in their pocket. So if you see, if this government in latest budgets, they told that they will sell LIC in stock markets. They will reduce the stake and they will. So this government, if they can sell LIC, stake in LIC, why can't they privatize Steel Authority? So there is a strong case of privatization. We don't know right now going forward. If they see this government also tried to sell BPCL. So a lot of, and this government already had sold Balco and Hindustan Zinc in 2002 to Vedanta. So this is clear indication from the government after LIC that they will sell the companies and they will privatize these businesses. Steel Authority, which is having reasonable debt, the businesses which are having cash, enough cash, can buy these companies. So there is a strong case of privatization for Steel Authority. So if you look industry outlook, this is National Steel Policy 2030. So before buying a steel stock, what you need to do is what industry, where the industry is headed. If you have seen, I am showing here two charts, two maps. First is planned industrial corridors in India, and second is planned smart cities. So if you have seen the planned industrial corridors, because of that, there will be lot of consumption of steel. And planned smart cities, if you have seen, I recently went to Bilaspur and I was surprised to see the development. And I have traveled across India. I was surprised to see the level of work it is going on central front, all highways and all. So because of these planned corridors and smart cities, there will be huge demand going forward also. With the current Indian capacity, current installed Indian capacity is 138 million ton per annum. As per the National Steel Policy, government wants to increase the installed capacity to 300 million ton per annum. Given the past record of growing at 7% in the past few decades, target of 300 million ton per annum set by the National Steel Policy is not too ambitious. Why? Because we have already done that in the last 20 years. So it is not too big ambitious. So 60 to 65% of the demand comes from this infrastructure sector. So the robust demand and pricing scenario will be only when the sector spends will be high. And because of this corona and all, we will be having huge population who will be unemployed. So because of that, government will pump money in the infrastructure. They don't have any other source than to either they can give money in pockets of people so that they spend, like reducing tax and all. Otherwise, they can keep on the same tax rate and they can spend more on infrastructure. I feel the cases of spending on infrastructure is more. Why? Because if we can control this coronavirus, there will be lot of players from outside. They want to invest in India because they don't want to invest in China now. Why? Because they have seen the effect of China and they are blaming China for all this coronavirus. So India will be at bigger advantage. I feel that investments in infrastructure will be huge going forward. If you see per capita consumption of steel, South Korea, per capita consumption of South Korea is 1047 kgs. If you see China, it is 590 kgs. And if you see India, it is just 73 kgs. So there is huge, and world average is 307 kgs. So even if we don't touch world average also, it is 225. So even if we don't touch world average also, even if we go from 73 to 150, it is great for us. If we just move from 73 to 150, there will be huge demand for steel. So I see a strong case for steel industries going forward. Just because in last 10 years, it was a bad period of steel industries, people are thinking that steel cannot create wealth, but it is not like that. See, it is the characteristic of a sector. 7 to 10 years of bad period leads to 4 to 5 years of good period. So we have already seen big negative for this sector from the last 10 years. But going forward, we will be the leaders. China will become Japan and India will become China. This is what I say. So because of that, what will happen? India will be on the growth trajectory. So even if you see, lot of people may argue that China is dumping steel in India. So even if you see China, they are cutting down the production because of pollution. If you have seen, China has closed down most of its outdated and inefficient induction furnaces. Government has introduced pollution-induced curtailment. So because of that, what has happened? If you have seen from 2015 to 2019, the production of China's production of steel, it is coming down. So people may also argue that some Chinese are setting up their plant in Vietnam and other countries and they may export from that. But if we have to safeguard our industry, we have to bring import duty. So government is very keen to save this industry, because they are if they don't save this industry, then India will be at a big problem. So going forward, we will be seeing lot of import duties on these countries. So there is, it is not a big issue for the countries. So what are the negatives or possible risks? Prolonged weakness in the economy. Now, right now, because of coronavirus, what will happen for the next 6 to 8 months or 1 year? It will be bad phase for the Indian economy. Because of that, what will happen? The stock price may be in range. So it is a negative, but it is a negative, but not a risk. Why? Because this company is a leader and it is having manageable debt. So for next 6 months, even if it is bad, stock price may go down to from 28 to, it may go down to 18. So it is not a big. So if you are looking 10x kind of return or 20x kind of return, 28 becoming 20, it is not a big issue. Why? Because it is volatility. It is not a risk. So dumping of steel from China, I don't see that happening. Why? Because government will be imposing import duties. Just because we have came out of huge NPA, government will not take that risk. They will impose import duty. So this, just to find out the risk, I am just listing down. So delaying ramping up capacity. Right now they are working at 14.5 million ton capacity, 16 million ton capacity, capacity utilization. If they are not able to ramp up the capacity utilization, then it is negative. So we need to check what all is happening with the story. So what is my take is, with 21.4 million ton capacity, as of now, Steel Authority has the largest capacity in, it is the largest company in India in terms of Indian installed capacity. JSW Steel has an installed capacity of 18 million ton, and Tata Steel is having 18.5 million ton. Both are working about 90%. Actually, recently, before the lockdown, it was working at 95% capacity utilization. JSW Steel has announced its Dolvi capacity plant expansion, and it is expected to be commissioned by late 2021. And because of this corona, it may come get over by 2023 also. Tata Steel's Kalinganagar plant expansion will come live by mid-2022. With all this scenario, it is clearly evident that supply will be tight. Why? Because the new capacity expansion, and from that expansion, again to ramp up, they will again take 1 to 1 year more. So for them to ramp up from 2021 to 2023, there will not be new capacities. However, at the same point of time, there will be huge demand. So whenever there is demand from 2021 to 2023, Tata Steel will be having a big disadvantage. JSW Steel has a big disadvantage. However, Steel Authority, which is currently at 60% capacity utilization, will give them enough room to ramp up the sales with enhanced pricing profile. They will make most in the industry. One is, these people will sell more. And second thing is, these people will make more profit on increased sales. That is biggest advantage for Steel Authority. From a valuation point of view, Steel Authority is trading at a highly pessimistic valuation, as if this company is going to go bankrupt. This is not going to happen, because it is working at a normal debt. So to install 1 million ton steel plant, it requires 6,500 crores. For 21.4, replacement cost will be 1,39,000 crores. Actually, it is 1,39,000 crores. It is not 13,900 crores as written in the slide. This is 1,39,000. While the current market cap is just 9,000 to 10,000 or 11,000 crore market cap. In the past cycle from 2003 to 2008, where sale was having 15,000 crore debt in 2003, and it became a debt-free company with 13,500 crore cash on its balance sheet in 2008. The stock became 23x in just 5 years. During 2006-7-8, every steel player thought that this demand run will continue and added huge capacities. And then global slowdown happened. This was hunting the entire sector for the next one decade from 2008 to 2018. With the recent consolidation in the Indian steel industry, it is set for the next leg of move for the next 5 to 6 years. Possibility of similar situation in 2020 to 2025. And now because of corona, it will be 2021 to 2026. period like 2003 to 2008, where consumption outgrew growth, outgrew the production is high, it will be the period of super normal profits for Indian steel companies. So my bet, best bet to play this upcoming steel upcycle is SAIL, which is trading at bankruptcy valuation. With all things in place like captive iron ore mines, operating leverage, increased labor productivity, deleveraging of balance sheet, steel authority is taking all steps in the right direction. As per the per capita consumption of steel will rise from sub 80 kgs to 120 to 150 kgs. Steel authority is at an inflection point to create huge wealth for its investor. This is not wealth. Let me talk fortune. So at this price, if my thesis plays out, actually we are sitting up for the big fortune creation for the shareholders, for the investors. SAIL, which has debt of around 50,000 crore, it is not 40,000, 45,000, it is actually 52,000 crore. We will be seeing this company at a negligible debt or debt-free company or debt-free cash-rich company by 2024. No, not 2024, 2025. This slide I wrote before coronavirus. Because of coronavirus, it may 1 year, let us increase one more year. Instead of 2025, it will be 2026. Steel Authority has already worked at 110% capacity utilization earlier in the past. So it will not be a big new thing for them to work at similar capacity utilization. With 21.4 million ton capacity in place, Steel Authority can do a sales of 90,000 to 1 lakh crore and a net profit of 10,000 to 15,000 crore. So as per my philosophy, I want to buy the businesses 5 years down the line. They should be able to do a net profit of it equivalent to the current market cap. So the current market cap of the company is 10,000 crore. So this company has the potential to do a profit of 10 to 15,000 crore in next 5 to 6 years. With the greater pull theory kicking in, Steel Authority, which is a cyclical company, will be looked as a growth company and thus valuation will be on rise. Earlier, Steel Authority has traded at 7 to 18 times earnings. Means, and if the annual profit is 10,000 crores, this had traded at 1,80,000 crores, 18 times profit at 2008 top. One can imagine what market cap it can get if it does a 10,000 crore, and that will be a whooping 20 to 25 times than the current market cap. So if they can do a 10,000 crore net profit, this company can post on a 15,000 crore, 10,000 crore profit. Even if we take 15 times earnings, then also this company can do a market cap of 1,50,000. Current market cap is just 10,000, which is 15x from here. So whatever, anything may happen about 10x, 10x, 20x, 25x. As of now, we know the downside. We don't know the upside. That is the best thing to do. Why? Because upside is like 10x. Or it may become even 20x. So minimum is 10x. This is what I am feeling. This is my personal views. So Steel Authority is a low risk, high uncertainty opportunity, which will be under few bets, big bets and infrequent bets category. Personally for me, I was searching for a stock where I could put 50% of my net worth in a single stock, just from a confidence point of view. I am ready to wait for 5 to 6 years to get such an opportunity, wherein heads I win, tails I don't lose at all. One can make big profits by putting small money in 100 bagger, but it is very difficult to find 100 bagger. So instead of doing that, it is better to put money where your mouth is, and it is better to put money where your circle of competence is. Steel is in my circle of competence. I have worked in JSW Steel Complex for a few months as an intern. During that period, I understood various plants in integrated steel plant like sponge iron plant, steel melt shop, blast furnace, raw material and its handling system, billet caster, hot roll coil, cold roll strips and all. So I worked with my father for 10 years related to the iron and steel industry and metals. The way I understand these businesses, that it becomes easier for me to study metal cycles. Personally, I feel we cannot be 100% right about the industry which we have not worked into. So I have made utmost effort to bring all these assessments for you all people. My blog followers who contacted me and made them understand this opportunity when it was trading at 31-34. We bought in huge, and when it bottomed out around 36 and the trend chain breakout on technical. Actually, Steel Authority, we bought at around 31-32-33, and recently before Corona, it went up to 52. So within few months, we booked trading profits and we held all those investing stocks. So what happened is automatically what all we bought, our purchase power came down. So because of that, the booking profits at 48, 49, 52, I'll be showing you that in next webinar. I have missed a lot of things in this webinar. In the next webinar, I'll be showing you this, that how I gave a personal view on Steel Authority when it was trading at 36. I told all people that risk is just 2 rupees on technical front, and the upside which we can see is 50 rupees in short term. So I'll be sharing with you all. Just be in touch. Steel Authority is just thus a not so obvious wealth creating opportunity. It is heads I win, tails I don't lose. So time will only tell how much money we have made here. With enough patience and conviction, we'll be able to see the levels of 100, 200, 300 and even 500. Current price is just 25, 26 or something like that. So let us, I have presented my views on Steel Authority and complete research, because actually I started working in my circle of competence, and what all 5 stocks I will be talking in this 5 stock series. In that webinar, I have taken this first webinar. So this is a 2-year research effort, and I feel I can answer most of the questions and most of the queries you will be having. So just feel free to ask each and every, and even if it is a dumbest of the dumb question, don't feel shy to ask me the question. So don't feel shy to ask me the question. Just ask me the question. Before that, I would like to tell, I take 2 courses.